Hi, I'm Jeff Switovy, Business Unit Manager for Wachs Utility Products. I'm here alongside of our compact LX valve maintenance trailer. It's part of a larger family of valve maintenance trailers and valve maintenance products. It includes the valve exercising arm, a Class 2 hydraulic power system, and a hydraulic hose reel, as well as service light package. The purpose of this video today is we'll cover the unpacking and setup of the equipment, the features of the equipment, the testing of the various systems, as well as any maintenance that's required to ensure the equipment performs for a long period of time. So when you receive your compact LX trailer or your TravelVac 300 for that matter, they both share the exact same trailer base. The unit will be mounted down to a pallet. There'll be stake sides all the way around it. I've already removed the stake sides. So the unit is sitting on top of the pallet with the tires and wheels underneath it. The tongue is bolted to the side of it, and the jack is bolted to the far side. So we're gonna have to go ahead and unbolt the base trailer, lift it up, and then bolt wheels to it, slide the tongue in the end of it, and mount the jack to it. And that's the process we're gonna go through next. The tools required for this, all the lag bolts that secure the equipment down to the pallet require a 9/16 wrench. You'll need a 15/16 combination wrench and a 15/16 socket. You also need a 3/4 socket. The 15/16 are used for the bolts that secure the tongue, and the 3/4 are used for your lug nuts. You'll also need a torque wrench capable of up to 100 foot-pounds. Because we will be lifting this off of the pallet, you'll also need a fork truck. This unit weighs, its dry weight is probably about 1,100 pounds, so most fork trucks you'll have access to will have the capability of lifting this up. So let's go ahead and loosen the trailer itself from the base skid. There are two lag bolts. They're located on the flange of the axle, right on the front side. So we'll go ahead and remove those. There's one. And two. Now the trailer itself is keyed to the pallet. So those bolts really only acted as pins to stop the unit from bouncing off of the pallet. So there's only two bolts that hold that unit down to the top of the pallet. In order to get access for your forks, you'll need to open up the rear doors at the back of the trailer. These rear doors are what is used to secure your telescoping valve key. So I'll just lay these over on the side for right now. Okay, so now with the trailer unit itself free from the pallet, I'll go ahead and take the fork truck here and align it. Align the forks with those two openings that I had just opened previously, where I took the telescoping valve key out of. And I'll put the forks inside there, and I'll lift it up, and I'll bring the entire trailer unit back to pretty much where the fork truck is right now. Now that we have the trailer system itself removed from the top of the pallet, it is suspended in air on the forks, so we want to make sure that at no point in time do we climb underneath the trailer. I'm going to mount the tires first because I need to be able to lower this all the way down and put resistance on the tires so I'm able to torque them. Once that's done, then I'll put jack stands in the front and I'll slide the tongue in. So let's go ahead and begin by mounting the tires. All the fasteners are located in the storage bin, along with your HC100 and the hubcaps for the tires. In the bin, you'll have 10 half-inch cone lug nuts. You'll have a couple of 5/8 bolts to secure your tongue. And you'll also have a nut and washer that's used for securing the jack to the tongue. These are 14-inch tires mounted on steel rims. So they will be torqued to a value of 100 foot-pounds. What I need to do first is mount the tire, and I'll just finger tighten all of these lug nuts. Okay, I put both tires on this, and notice, like I said, I don't have any jack stands under it yet. So what I'm gonna wanna do is I'm gonna wanna go ahead and lower the trailer so that the ground will react with the tires. And that way I'll be able to go ahead and torque each one of the lug nuts properly. Once I get the lug nuts on both sides tightened, I'll go ahead and raise it up a little bit, put jack stands under the front, lower it back down so it's resting on the wheels and the jack stands, and then I'll slide the tongue in. So let me go ahead and do that now. Now I have my torque wrench already set for 100 foot-pounds. Because these are steel wheels and then it's not compressible like an aluminum mag wheel is, I can go ahead and take this using a star pattern, top lug, 5 o'clock. I'll come back over here to 9 o'clock. I'll come over here to 3 o'clock and I'll go back down over here to 7 o'clock. And I'll probably do that 2 times at 100 foot-pounds. But because they're steel wheels, they're not compressible like the aluminum, so I can go right to torque on this. Okay, I've gone ahead and torqued all 5 bolts on the one tire, all 5 on the other. I've got a couple of jack stands here. I'll go ahead and raise the trailer up slightly, slide the jack stands underneath, and lower the trailer back down onto those so that I can operate underneath the unit to slide the tongue in. Once again, it's the same 9/16 lag bolts that secure this tongue to the pallet. Now on the tongue itself, the wire harness has already been run through the tube of the tongue. So on the end here, you're going to want to snake this back out. Let me go ahead and raise the trailer up. And we're going to slide it in with the pintle ring and its interface kind of facing towards the top. I do have my wires all pushed in to the end. I'll go ahead and slide it in the front here. You'll see the first hole right here. The corresponding hole inside the receiver is right about here at the edge of this white reservoir. I'll grab my two bolts and nuts. Now these are locking nuts. You can see the impression on the side of these nuts. So although I will install it here for our demonstration, I will not tighten it down. These get tightened to 80 foot-pounds, and you will need a 15/16 wrench and a 15/16 a torque wrench. I showed you those at the beginning of the video. So before I climb under there, I'll get this first bolt in the right place. Okay, first one's in. You can see I'm locked in place now. Grab some scrap cardboard, because the rest of this job you'll have to do on your back. And I'll slide that under there. The wire harness that was tucked inside the tongue, I'm going to retrieve, and there's a matching weather pack connection for it right underneath. I'll have to make that connection while I'm under there. All right, so I got the first bolt on the front of the tongue. I'm going to grab my second bolt, my washer and my nut, and my 15/16 wrench and my 15/16 inch torque wrench, as I have to do the remainder of this from underneath. All right. So I'll go ahead and slide the wire harness out. You can see it right here. I'll make this connection, the weather pack connection right here. There you go, make sure that clips in place. So there's your brake lights and your turn signal lights. I'll go ahead and get this started here. And like I said, these are swedge nuts, so they are one-use nuts, so I'm not going to tighten this. I'm not gonna lock it in place. You get the first bolt here, and you have one more at the back of the tongue here. And you might have to wiggle your wire there to get it. There we go. There we go. And like I said, you got a deep well 15/16 torque wrench, and I like using box wrenches so they don't fall on your head. I'll use it to secure the other side, and I'll tighten these up to 80 foot-pounds. And that's it as far as securing the tongue into the trailer. Okay, with the tongue mounted to the trailer, now I need to mount the jack to the tongue. And same process as before, let's remove these lag bolts. Okay, the jack is going to secure itself to the front of this tongue with a 3/4 inch, you need a 3/4 inch socket. I'm cheating here, and I'm going to use a ratchet wrench because it is kind of difficult to reach around the jack tube with a socket or with a regular open-ended wrench. You'll need to grab there's a special washer and a nut. I'm keeping this with the unit that we're shipping, and I'm going to use a spare one here, so that I don't damage. This is once again a swedge nut. It's only good for one use. So I'm gonna use a different one than what is shipping with the unit. To install this, the washer has a step on it. You're gonna wanna make sure the small diameter of the step faces inward. That way when I torque this nut, the jack will still be able to pivot freely. Normally I would just simulate mounting this, but because I'm going to go ahead and remove the fork truck from the picture, I want to make sure that I have a secure jack in the front. There we go, that's it. Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and raise it up, pull my jack stands out, and then lower it back down on the ground, and then pull the fork truck out of the way. There we go. Okay, so with the fork truck removed, the tires are on, the tongue is in place. I can go ahead and return the telescoping valve key back into its storage spot. Only task I really have left is to make sure my tires are properly inflated, check the lube on the axles, and then put my hubcaps on. We change tires upon occasion, so I don't want to tell you a tire pressure that is universal for all of our units. These particular ones, 50 PSI is what the cold pressure should be, but definitely make sure you check the rating on the tire and make sure it's properly inflated. Check the wheel bearing grease. These are greased at the factory. These are Dexter axles. These are easy lube axles. You pull the little rubber grommet off and you'll see the grease zerk right in the very center. When grease is shot in through the very center, it reaches the back of the bearing and then starts working forward. So when you can see this is properly packed, but tens of thousands of miles later, you might want to repack this. And as you start seeing fresh grease come out, you know your bearings have been repacked with clean new grease. Last step is to apply the wheel cover and just align these with the lug nuts and it just snaps in place. Okay, so now we're gonna try and go over all the features on this particular unit. You can see this is a trailer version of our Compact LX. It ships with the 2 5/16 pintle, but it's also available with a 2-inch ball. You have a wheel jack stand on the very front. Then at the front of the trailer, we have a Class 2 hydraulic power unit. It's a 16-horse V-twin engine with the fuel tank integral to it, and also a electric fuel solenoid, so that at no point in time do you have to worry about reaching over there and turning the fuel petcock on and off. That's operated by the central electrical system located on the front of the HPU. You have a series of quick disconnects here for a loose hose set. You also have on the LX, you also get a 50-foot hydraulic hose reel. You'll see through this window right here is where the oil level and oil temperature can be seen. It's a glass tube for your temperature, and you'll be able to see the condition of the oil, whether it's a nice clean amber color, and the level of it by looking right at that tube. You have a throttle, which is push the button in, and then you can pull and push it, or you can rotate it out or rotate it in for fine control. You also have a lock here. If you have a particular throttle range that you're running and you want to make sure it stays there, typically if you're running the Class 2 hydraulic circuit, you'll want to be max RPM, and then you can go ahead and lock the throttle in place. But for valve exercising, typically 1200 RPM, 1400 RPM is all you need to do. You have a choke right beneath it. You have your diverter valves. This top diverter valve here, when I pull it out, it routes oil to the your auxiliary hydraulic disconnects right here on the front panel. When I push it in, it routes the oil to a second valve. This second valve has two position as well. When I pull it out, it diverts oil to the hydraulic hose reel. So if you want to use the auxiliary hydraulic hose reel, you'll want to make sure you have this pushed in and this one pulled out. When you're not using the hydraulic hose reel, in the typical normal condition, this will be pushed in and oil will be running to your valve machine. Also on the front here, you have a tiny tech. When the unit is turned off, it shows your engine hours. When the engine's running, it gives you RPM. You have your pressure gauge here, and we'll use that when we're checking the hydraulic systems later in this video. On the front panel here, we have a couple of keys fastened for shipping. The silver ones here I use for starting the engine. And for right now, I'll store that right here. So we have two sets of keys here on the front. Both these boxes are identical, so you do actually get an extra set of keys. You have a lock here on the front, which you can unlock, and then you have a lever here, which will open up and give you access to the light bar control. The default configuration is from the inside of the light bar to the outside. It's always set for high, so it's typically high visibility. Normally you don't have to mess with this whatsoever. It's usually on all the time. The other one, this is how you turn your service lights on, these pivot and pan. And then you also have a voltmeter here. Inside this particular one, you also have your circuit breakers. So those are located inside here as well. The hydraulic reservoir, in addition to the control and instrumentation that's on the front of it, it also has a heat exchanger built into there. So it does give you a complete class 2 hydraulic circuit with 5 horsepower of heat dissipation coming from that that heat exchanger located here in the front. The fan itself for that is thermostatically controlled. So when you turn the unit on, you won't hear anything, but should the oil temperature still be over temperature, that fan would kick on when I turn the key switch on. The business end of it here is your ERV750. This gives you 13 foot of reach from the center of the pedestal. There are a couple of locks on here. You have a typical maintenance lock. This is what you'll be using on a regular basis as you move from valve to valve. And then you also have a transport lock, a secondary lock located here in the back. And then stepping around the back here, we have bin storage. And located in this area right now, when you receive it, you'll get your HD100. And I'll cover the contents of that here in a second. Normally you might have the loose fasteners that were used when we set this unit up. You might store other things in here, like maybe some valve key adapters, maybe a submersible pump, maybe something else you run off your class 2 hydraulic circuit that might be stored down inside that bin as well. We have storage across the back. This is what I was using the fork truck to spear with. On the one side is the standard key set that goes with this unit. This is a 4 foot through 9 foot telescoping valve key. There are middle sections here. These are 3 foot sections. So you can go from 4 foot to 9 foot to 4 foot to 12 foot, 4 foot to 15 foot, 4 foot to 18 foot by continuing to add these 3 foot sections. We'll go over that shortly as well. The other bay, you might have some unique valve situations in your distribution system. Maybe you need a short key. We have for those in warmer weather climate, we have short keys that go all the way down to 3 foot. Maybe you have a custom one made for your distribution system. Maybe you've got some metric valves in your system. This gives you the capability of storing a whole nother set of adapters and keys in the second bay here. The light bar, as you saw from the side a minute ago, you have work lights for operating at night, for illuminating your job site, as well as the light bar mounted in the center there. We have 50 foot hydraulic hose reel here. So depending on the selector valves in the front of your reservoir, you can divert the hydraulic flow from the valve machine over to your hydraulic system. Note that both of the auxiliary hydraulic systems, the one that were on the front panel of the reservoir and this one, these are both deadheaded. So if you do throw your valves over there and you're sending oil to either the front panel or to the hose reel, know you're deadheading your hydraulic system and you start building up heat really, really fast. You might even have a hard time starting the engine because those valves are in the wrong position, because you're trying to compress oil into a deadheaded hydraulic system and it's very difficult to try and start a motor in that condition. Even though there is a pressure relief set in there at 2000 PSI, it's still very difficult for that starter on that small motor. The lights that are mounted on the back of the fenders, those are all LED lights. There's lights on the side and lights in the back. And the only other feature that I wanted to explain left on the equipment is your handheld controller that comes with this unit. This is the HC100. I'm going to unpack this real quick. Inside your literature package, you'll end up with a warranty card. You got information here on our ERV750. You also have information here on the entire Compact LX valve maintenance system as a whole. The Vital software manual is only available either when you install the software on your PC. It also installs a user's manual, or it can always be downloaded from our webpage. It's constantly changing, so we don't include it in our mass production print runs of the manual. You end up with a machine controller cable. Although this device is Bluetooth enabled, as you see here, sometimes you just need to make sure you have a cable, because Bluetooth connections sometimes are a little bit finicky. You might be operating in an area where there's a lot of radio frequency noise, or you might have had someone interested in the other cool things that this controller can do and starts messing with the Bluetooth communication settings. So you get a control cable. Here is the HC100. Before you go and do your in-service with your customer, make sure you charge this thing up, because it is only a very light charge that it arrives with, enough for us to do testing with it, but not enough to do any type of meaningful in-service where you go out there and operate a few valves. You have a USB cable, which allows you to sync your HC100 to your desktop computer. You get a DC charger, so you can charge up your unit while you're in the field. Although these lithium ion batteries are really, really, really good. You typically will get 3 days to a week out of a single charge. But in the event someone does forget to charge it or leaves it on or something, you have the ability to charge it up while you're on the road. You also have an AC charger and a multitude of interfaces. So one of the things I wanted to mention as we're covering the general arrangement of this valve maintenance trailer is the overlying philosophy on all of our systems is safety and efficiency. All the access points that you'll need in order to perform your normal duties are on the curbside or on the back of the equipment. It's optimized around a two-man crew that goes out there. So you'll have one crew member staging the work site and directing traffic, while the other crew member is grabbing the valve key, dropping the hole, grab his machine, plopping it over the top of the valve key and doing the valve exercise. Two-man work crew, safe work environment. So our equipment's been completely assembled, and what I'm gonna wanna do is make sure all the systems are functioning properly. So before I start the engine, I'm gonna wanna check a couple of the fluids. I wanna check the engine oil. We only offer this particular unit in gasoline. So I'll come around the back side here and I'll pull the dipstick. And I'll make sure that the oil level is proper, and it is. And the other fluid that we need to check is going to be our hydraulic oil. I mentioned this earlier during the features portion of it, but right inside this window, you'll see the temperature gauge, and you'll see at the very top, you'll see an air bubble, which will indicate the oil level inside this reservoir. So if I take a look, the oil bubble's right about here. So this reservoir runs from here to here. It's 10 gallons. It is full. So we're good to go with our fluids. So I'll go ahead and we're gonna start the engine. We're gonna check the hydraulic system first. I'm gonna do that by deadheading my systems, and that'll bring the pressure gauge right to 2000 PSI. I wanna make sure I don't have any leaks, both in this system and in the hose reel system. Once that's done, then we'll go ahead and check our ERV and our lighting, our electrical system. So we're gonna go ahead and check out our hydraulic system by deadheading the hydraulics. As I mentioned during the features portion of it, if you have a hard time starting your engine, most likely it's because one of your valves is in the wrong position. I'll give it a little choke. Get some gas. Try the front one first. And you see my pressure gauge comes right to 2000 PSI. So that was for this one. Now I'm sending oil over to the second valve, and right now it's running through the ERV, which is open center, and back to the tank. So I'll go ahead and pull this, and it'll send oil to the hydraulic reel. Once again, 2000 PSI. You're gonna wanna take a look around, make sure you don't have any leaks anywhere. And that all looks good, so I'll go ahead and throttle down. As mentioned, when we get to the point in time when we're actually doing valve exercising and during normal activities, you'll want to typically have your engine RPM right around 1500 RPM. That's more than enough for doing valve exercise. The hydraulic system is direct coupled to that motor. So the faster the engine spins, the more gallons per minute you're pumping through your hydraulic system. So at this RPM, at this engine RPM, we're gonna be running about 30 RPM at the head. So as I give it more gas, you'll see the RPM of the ERV faster and faster. So in order to get a full class 2 hydraulic for your auxiliary tools, you'll need full RPM, and that'll give you 8 gallons per minute. We can go ahead and verify our electrical system's working. The voltmeter right now is at 14 volts. When I turn the engine off, that voltmeter drops all the way down to about 12. And you see it's dropping right now. Turn the key switch on so we can see it. So we're right about 12.6, which is normal. As soon as I start the engine, give it a little gas. You see it starts climbing to 13. It's right about 13 and a half right now, still climbing for about 14. So at least I know the charging system on my motor is working properly. I want to go ahead and check our service lights. I'll turn that on, and we can see my work lights are on. And by default, right now my aero board is on, so I can verify that as well. Check the various patterns. Light intensity. On off. So normally we just leave it defaulted on, so as soon as the engine's running, your aero board's already on. So now the only system we have left to check is gonna be the ERV. And I wanna go ahead and verify that the hydraulic system's working on the machine, as well as the connectivity between the HC100 and the machine. I'll go ahead and remove my restraints. That's the typical one you'll use throughout the course of your day. Then you also have a transport restraint. Turn my key switch on, or my toggle switch on in the back. I press the green button, and it releases my hydraulic system. As soon as I release the green button, it locks back down in place again. So I know my hydraulic system's working. And I also know I'm getting power to my machine. So one of the interesting features of this machine is some of the programming that goes into our control system helps you do a little bit of site diagnostics by knowing what the codes mean. When I turn the power switch on for my ERV, you'll see it's strobing right now. It's called a heartbeat. It lets you know that the CPU for the machine is operating, it's got power and it's operating normally. When I connect up my HC100 to this and I pair its Bluetooth, in addition to getting the heartbeat, you'll also get a little flow, you'll get a fast one and then a slow one, a fast one and then a slow one. And that fast pulse is telling you that it's also got a Bluetooth connection and that connection is strong. So a nice little feature that you can pay attention to and know that you've got good working functions just by knowing what the flashing pattern is on the end of the bat. So now I know I've got hydraulics. I know my electrical system is good for my machine. So I'm going to check to make sure the HC100 operates the machine properly. I'll go ahead and remove it from the box. I'm going to first test with the control cable. Always check with the control cable first. It's got an RS-232 jack on the bottom. So I'll connect that in there. And then it interfaces with the ERV right here on the side port. It is keyed, so you gotta make sure it's either gonna be down and forward, like this one is, or it's gonna be up and back, like this. This one's down and forward. Once you get it pushed in, then go ahead and secure it in place with the ferrule. I'll turn my HD100 on. And this was powered all the way off. And I'll show you how to do that when we complete our video. You need to hold the power button down until you have a screen to power it all the way off. Because if you just hit the power button, it goes into sleep mode. So normally when crews are using the equipment, when they're going from valve to valve to valve, they'll just hit the sleep button. So it's almost instantaneous turning on and off. Okay, so after the unit is turned on, it automatically loads right into our vital screen. And in order for me to check the operating condition of the machine, I'll go right into controller. And you'll see across the bottom here, it says cable connection to ERV750. So immediately look for a cable connection to the machine. One thing I'll also do is I want to make sure the pressure transducers that are located here on the machine, which is how we determine the output torque of the machine, let's make sure those are in good condition. So by pressing the bar where it says cable connection to ERV750, you'll see some numbers right across the bottom here. And this, they're all a comma delineated. So the first number is 0, and then you'll have a 3-digit number, a comma, and a second 3-digit number. Those are the actual readings off of these transducers right now. And because there is, the hydraulic system is open to tank, meaning there's no back pressure anywhere, these should measure almost exactly the same. When I'm operating the machine on a valve one way or the other, those numbers will spike higher one way and then higher the other way, depending on which direction it's turning. So right now they should be very close to the same. And right now it's showing 106, 107 on one and 106 on the other. So it's pretty much spot on. And I know that I can operate my machine and this can be very, very accurate. The other thing I'm gonna wanna check on this, I'm gonna wanna make sure that my encoder is operating properly. So we have pressure and then we have number of turns. Those are the two things that we wanna check. So I'm gonna go ahead and exit out of here. And I'm gonna go into diagnostics. They asked me if I've read the manual. I hit okay. So the one, there's several things that are included in the diagnostics. But the one I wanna check first, I wanna check that the counter is operating properly. So the way we do the counter test, when I click on that and I hit okay, you have a control screen here. And what it's gonna do is it's gonna, when I hit start, it'll first try and do right hand 5 full turns. And what I'm gonna wanna do is make sure that when my controller says it sees 5 turns, which is 10 pulses per turn, when it sees 5 full turns, that the output of my ERV has actually gone 5 turns. So we're gonna go ahead, you can use any point of reference. Normally, when these are tested at our facility, there'll be a mark on the top of the machine, and in this particular case there is. So I'm gonna remove my swivel socket, get this out of the way. We'll come back to it later. And on the very top of my machine here, there's a couple of marks here from where they were testing it before. So what I'm gonna wanna do is, I'm just gonna use my finger and I'll place it next to this red mark that's already there. And I'll just go ahead and hit okay. Run. So it's gonna turn right ham. And there's one. Two. Three. It should stop this time around. And like I said, the resolution of this is 36 degrees. It's 360 degrees divided by 10 pulses. So as long as I'm stopping within, you know, 30 degrees of motion, that's as accurate as you're gonna be able to get. So I stopped within the width of my finger, certainly accurate enough. So it counted accurately to the right. So now I'm gonna change direction to left hand, hold my finger at the same spot and hit run. One, two, three, four, five. Once again, stop within the width of my finger. I'm good. And it shows down there that it did five turns. So the encoder is working properly. While I'm in the diagnostic screen, I'll share with you guys a little pro tip. The brake button that is used for positioning the machine, it's always exposed to the elements and it's subject to a lot of repeated abuse. In the event you happen to start running into failure, this handle changes out real easy. A bolt on the bottom, this comes off, and your quick disconnect is right here. But you might not have another one of these with you. I can go to, in the diagnostics, I can go to the brake section and I can create a virtual brake. It's right here. So when I hold this button, it's no different than holding this button. So if I press the button here, I can move my machine, and then when I release it, it locks my machine in place again. So in the event this button starts giving you problems years down the road, know that you've always got a backup for that with your controller. So once we've gone through the diagnostics portion of it, it is a separate program, so as soon as I exit out of it, it drops me back to the main Windows screen. So in the lower right-hand corner is the Vitals program, so you click that again so I can launch Vitals. That's loading. What I'm going to want to do is I want to test the Bluetooth functionality now. So I'm going to go ahead and disconnect this cable. And once again, you loosen the ferrule and remove it. Don't try and turn this, you'll end up breaking these. So I'm disconnected here. I'll go back into controller. And what it's doing is it wants to look for the last connection I had, which was the cable connection. So it asks, hey, there's nothing on that COM port. Do you want me to do an auto connect to see if I can find something? I'll say yes. So it starts looking through the available COM ports. And there it found a COM port. Now you see across the bottom where it used to say cable connection to ERV750. Now that bar is lit up blue, and it says Bluetooth connection to ERV750. So now, I can go anywhere I want with this. So if you find yourself in the middle of an intersection with the arm extended out into traffic, I can go stand on the sidewalk and operate my machine. You can see there, I hit start. It's running like it normally would, all through the Bluetooth connection. Also through the Bluetooth connection, you have the ability, it does have a navigation grade GPS built into it, but you can also add a survey grade GPS unit where you see the RAM ball mount here. A second one is added to the far side, and then you would have we're currently selling a Trimble R2 unit that would Bluetooth to this device. So in the event I have this machine stuck out in the middle of traffic and I'm operating my valve, the GPS device is still over the valve, right over the valve, but my controller is over on the curb or inside the cab of the vehicle, someplace safe, and I'm collecting all the GPS points, and I'm safely operating my machine tool, where I'm not in a position where I might get compromised by the traffic. We've tested the machine, the hydraulic system, the electrical system. Checked all the fluids. The only thing left to do is there's a couple of ancillary items that we're going to want to make sure that they interface properly. So we're going to cover that next. I'm done with the HC100. So I'm going to want to hold the power button down. And you'll see another menu come up. And I'm going to want to power off. And that will, instead of putting it in a suspend mode, it'll go ahead and turn it actually off. And that way you will not be consuming any power while it sits for extended periods of time. So I'll go ahead and collapse the machine again. Okay, the last thing I want to check is a couple of the mechanical devices. The telescoping valve key. We're going to want to make sure that these pieces all fit together properly. It is a three-piece assembly. As I mentioned once before in the features section, I'm going to go ahead and cut the packaging tape off. So this is the bottom of the telescoping valve key, and it's got the an interface for your standard 2-inch AWWA nut. We have the top of the valve key right here, and then this is the midsection, which is what gives you the ability to grow in length beyond the 9 foot that this initially provides. And what I'm going to want to check for here is several things. One, that the interface between the valve key and the machine it fits properly, as well as make sure that these sections fit together with each other. So let me first check the, here is your extension, and that works proper. And then the top section, I want to verify that there are no burrs inside these holes, and that you get a secure fit. So now you notice on the top section, those holes are spaced at 8-inch intervals. And what that allows for is, because the valve machine itself is at a fixed height, this allows you to be able to adjust the telescoping valve key to the proper depth for your valve. Now, because they're on 8-inch increments, the remaining portion of deviation is made up in your universal socket. Your universal socket fits inside the head of the ERV and provides adjustability for 12 inches. So there's plenty of overlap. So this fits nicely inside the head of the ERV. And then you want to make sure that the key fits nicely inside the end of that socket, and it does. So in addition to having the additional 12 inches of range provided by this, you also get 30 degrees of misalignment each way. So in the event you've got to, your valve box is off at an angle from your valve, this allows you to correct for it and still have the machine remain perpendicular to the ground. So those all fit proper as they should. The normal operating position for this universal socket will be like this. It slides into the machine, the rubber washer goes down, and then your retaining pin. And it just stays this way for the remainder of its life. So now we're into the maintenance section of this orientation video. And there's not a lot of points that you need to address on here. You'll have the normal maintenance you would have on any type of small engine. It's covered in your owner's manual, the service interval for that. And you'll want to reference the engine hours located on the front of your tiny tack. The drain port for the engine is located on the back, and there's also an oil filter there. Like I said, there's a separate manual that covers maintenance for that Briggs & Stratton engine, so make sure you reference that. On the hydraulic reservoir, you are circulating hydraulic oil. If you happen to forget and leave one of your valves in the wrong position and you start burning your oil, that nice amber color that the hydraulic oil is now will start changing, and you'll want to change it. Or if you're running auxiliary tools, and the oil that's in those auxiliary tools contaminates your hydraulic system. You may have to change your oil more frequently, but just keep an eye on it. You don't want it cloudy, which would indicate you have some water in your system, or it starts turning dark brown like you might have burned it. So keep an eye on that. As far as lubrication points on the machine, there are quite a few of them. And like all of our equipment, I always recommend that you have a can of WD-40 handy to touch on a lot of these. The valve bodies here in the front of the reservoir, they are, the bodies themselves are cast iron, and the spools are a stainless steel, but you still get a rust ring on there, and they'll be difficult to operate. So periodically, I recommend you go ahead and pull the spool out, hit it with just a touch of the WD-40. See how easy that is now? Same again on the other one. Again, real nice and easy again. So hitting those periodically will stop you from having one of these valves freeze up from you. On the ERV itself, there's not a lot of lubrication points on here. The only point that I'll recommend people address is the rotors are fixed and the calipers float. These calipers float on these little caliper pins right here. And there's four of them on each one of the pivot points. And you can see between the caliper itself and the caliper pin, there's some white lithium grease in there. If you don't do anything and let this this caliper eventually freeze, then when you go to operate your ERV arm, it's gonna feel like the brakes are dragging. And that's because this caliper can't self-center and there's only pistons on one side. So it ends up pulling the brake disc over on one side, and then it can't fall back the other way on these pins because it's kind of frozen up. So in the event that ends up happening, you're gonna want to put a wrench on this, remove this nut, drive the pin down a little bit. There's this, a clip. You pull the clip out and then pull the pin back out the top, and then you polish them, re-grease them, and put them back on. But if you apply a little bit of grease to this periodically, then you won't have that happen to you. Most of it's contamination from debris is what causes that to lock up. You don't have any oxidation issues, as this is aluminum and these are stainless. So there's not really an oxidation issue there. It's mostly just contamination because they are exposed to the elements and you're driving down the road. So maintaining those pins. There are a couple of other points that I like to address. These lock pins, these are zinc plated and the springs are carbon steel. So a lot of times I like to tell our customers to go ahead and hit it with a little bit of WD-40 in there. That'll preserve that one. On the travel pin, this is a stainless steel pin and a stainless steel ball, but for whatever reason, the spring that's inside of it is carbon steel. I don't know why, it just is. So if you hit this, the ball a little bit and press the ball in with your thumb, one, it makes the insertion of this pin 100 times easier. And when you pull it out, you won't bang your knuckles on the caliper, but also stops it from rusting and it won't be a problem for you in the long run. I'm gonna go ahead and turn this on for a second and release this so I can show you the inside. When the machine is fully collapsed like this, it's got a reach of about 9 feet. You also have the ability to go an additional 4 feet by extending this arm. You loosen the lock and you pull the pin and the arm slides out. So this same pin, once again, it's a zinc coating on there. So I'll go ahead and hit this. And the lock bolt that's here, that's all black oxided carbon steel. So go ahead and hit that a little bit too. The WD-40 is your friend, but one of the things I wanted to stress is that lubrication and rust inhibitors are great as far as preventing rust, but they're not great if they get on your brake surfaces, which the machine requires in order to lock in place. So when you are lubricating these pins for the caliper, you have to make sure that none of it gets on your rotors here. It will get absorbed onto the pads and then your brakes won't work at all. So depending on what you're using to lubricate the joint between These calipers, you can see here, I'm just spinning it by hand right now. That's how loose these things should be. You want to make sure whatever lube you use that you don't get any of it onto the rotor, and that'll ultimately make it onto the pads, and then your machine won't lock in place. Thanks for watching. I hope this video benefited you, showed you how to unpack the equipment, set it up, how to test it, and verify that it's operating properly. Should you have any additional questions, always visit our website, turnvalves.com, where you can download latest copies of our manual, new versions of our operating software, Vitals, as well as find a representative in your area should you have further questions.